Dr. Patki is gynecologist in Mumbai. He practices at Fertility Associates. He completed MBBS and DGO. At Fertility Associates, they believe in having holistic approach of treatment to treatment of infertility problems. From investigation, individual assessment, to equipping couples with full information and helping them make informed decision for tailor-made treatment. Please welcome Dr. Patki on stage. Come on, we can have a better welcome for him.
Thank you so much, Shaina, and thank you to Anu for having me here. And in my short interactions with some of your team people, I'm really excited, and I hope I continue interacting with all of you in the future. I've had a series. Can I have the lights a little dim? I've had a series of meetings with Anu, and one day she just popped up this question and said, will you come and talk to my people on stress and how it affects infertility? And that got me thinking, because in our practice, we always believe that stress was part of their problem of the couple. And as I often said, that in the infertile group, they don't want to have a baby tomorrow, they wanted it yesterday. So they are that stressed. And particularly in India, we know that it is a problem of the whole family. It is discussed at dinner tables, and your aunts and your mother-in-law and your mom take you to various different doctors of repute, and you're pulled and tugged everywhere. And that makes it worse, because everybody knows you're trying to have a baby. And in that process, everybody is dropping a baby every year. So some of my patients come and tell me, doctor, I hate friends telling me that they're pregnant. I love them dearly. But when I get this call from a friend of mine who tells me that I'm pregnant, I just burst into tears. I'm happy for her, but that makes me really sad, because here I am trying and it's not happening. And now they are on their second baby, or sometimes even their third baby. It's a very typical picture. We were one of the first people in our group to get married, and we thought that we would have our babies. The last in our group has already got married and is already expecting their first baby. So there's a lot of peer pressure that happens in families also. And I think that just adds on to the stress. And quite often people say that my infertility is a blow to my self-esteem. As I said early, most of these couples are high achievers. They are A personalities. They have managed to do well in their school and college. They have not one but two degrees. They have got very plump jobs, doing exceedingly well, but unfortunately are not able to have a child. A violation of my privacy. Because often you are asked questions, do you have enough sex with your husband? Are you infertile? Quite often infertility is related to frigidity. It is related to low sex drive. It is related to everything, which is, in fact, it is not. It's an assault to my sexuality. It's a final exam on my inability to cope, an affront to my sense of justice. A painful reminder that nothing can be taken for granted. My infertility is a break in the continuity of my life. Above all, it's a wound. It's a wound to my body, to my psyche, and to my soul. Now, what is stress? We all know, I mean, you all are all experts to tell me what is stress. And I would define stress as an event that a person perceives is threatening. And in order to protect itself, we all have two kinds of responses, the fight and the flight response, which nature has allowed us to survive the stress and allow us to continue our life. Now, if I go into the science of the stress, we know that whenever there is stress, the brain, the hypothalamus, releases the CRF, which activates the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal system, or the HPO axis, as we call, and there is release of these stress hormones or catecholamines or cortisols they are steroids, and that really upsets the cart of hormones in each and every one of us. And that what causes women to not release their eggs, to have irregular periods. That what causes men to have their sperm counts drop down because there is a release of these steroid hormones. In the 1940s, infertility was defined as functional infertility. But in 1990s, after a lot of research and papers have come out, we know it is a neurotransmitted disease. We know it is related to the brain. We know it is related to hormones which are released from the brain. And I was just about talking to some of you all, and we know that there is a relation between hormones and psychological well-being of the person, as we would like to say. Now, stress doesn't affect women only, it affects men. We know that men who are in some high-powered job, who are highly stressed because of their job, because of the targets that they have to meet, have infertility problems, their sperm counts drop down, they have low semen volume, low sperm concentrations. If you actually measure their blood, we find that they have low testosterone levels, which means that there were low sex drive also accompanied with this. There was a fantastic study which was done on prisoners who were awaiting execution, who were on death penalty, and they found that their sperm counts were completely zero, absent sperm counts, because they are so stressed that their hormones are at their lowest levels and they did not produce any sperms. So we know that stress can affect both the husband and the wife, or the male and the female partner. And we know that quite often I tell couples to actually go for a few rounds of counseling sessions before they come back for treatment. I know that they may need IUI or they need IVF, but at present they are so stressed that I know the best of hands they will not conceive. We are typically seeing some professionals, like people working at call centers. I have a lot of young ladies who work at call centers, who work in the night, and we find that because they work in the night, they are up the whole night. Their shift finishes typically by 5-6 o'clock in the morning. They are dropped home, they go home and they sleep. So during the daytime, when the sunlight is supposed to stimulate the pineal gland, they're all indoors. They get up at 4 o'clock, they have their shower, they have something to eat, and the car comes to pick them up at 7 or 8. So they virtually meet nobody, they virtually see no sunlight, and this goes on for days and weeks, and we find that when we measure their hormones, they're completely disarray. They are women who actually go into amenorrhea. They don't get periods at all. And we find this with marathon runners. We find this in women who are undergoing stress because of long distance running. We find this in women who are athletes who are stressing their body. You find that their hormones come down. And this is like nature trying to protect themselves. Nature knows that they are not in the best of conditions to get pregnant. So the nature will try to get their hormones down, will not allow them to get pregnant. Now, can stress reduction aid in conception? Of course it can aid. This study was a landmark study done at the Harvard Medical School, which they conducted a 10-week program for women with unexplained infertility. When everything is right, the husband's counts are good, the woman is producing eggs every month, their tubes are fine, they still cannot get pregnant, and they found that when they underwent these counseling sessions or when they underwent stress reduction by various different methods, by yoga, by good nutrition, exercise, education of infertility, they found that more than half of them got pregnant within 6 months of completing this course. In our practice, when we find that there is a lot of stress, when they feel that age is catching up with them, when they have had few cycles of IVF failure behind them, I often advise them to go for adoption if they're happy to adopt a child. Because when you adopt a child and when a child comes home, your stress levels come down dramatically. And I tell them, you adopt a child and 2 years later you come back to me And I'm telling you, you will get pregnant with the same treatment I'm offering you now, because then there is no stress in you. And I've had several instances when women have come and thanked me and said, wish we had taken your advice earlier. We are so happy with this child that now, and they have undergone not only treatment, some of them conceived spontaneously on their own. And I've had these frantic calls saying, doc, I've missed my period. I should have asked you, but I did a urine pregnancy test and it's positive. I can't believe I'm pregnant. I've been trying for 15 years, 18 years, 20 years, and it's not happened. And here it has happened within 2 years of me adopting a child. Often it works. Often it works. And I really tell them that try and reduce your stress and come back, because I don't want to treat you in this frame of mind. You will not get pregnant. Stress management. I'm sure you all are more experts in this, but as a medical doctor, we have counselors on our team. Often I find that patients can't express their stress to us because they feel as doctors, we would not be able to empathize with them. We would not understand in a busy practice. We may not be able to give them time. So often we ask them to see the counselors. And in fact, every doctor on my team has undergone counseling skills, and they are actually certified counselors themselves. So in our own way, we try and counsel the patient to make sure that they are counseled. But if they need more counseling sessions, we often tell them to go and see the counselors. And when they come back, I find a dramatic improvement in their results, in their response to our medications and to the hormones. We have seen patients requiring less than half the doses of hormones that we had injected into them a few months before they actually underwent these counseling sessions. So we as doctors know stress can cause infertility, and stress reduction dramatically improves their chances of getting pregnant. When we go through a stress, I mean, this is not for y'all, this is for doctors, but I mean, this is a slide which tells that you have to be aware of what stresses you. You have to recognize what you can change. You should also recognize what cannot be changed and how you can surpass that. You reduce the physical reaction to your stress. You build up your physical reserves. And first and foremost, be a friend to yourself. I think it is extremely important. I tell women that they don't have to blame themselves, because quite often they blame themselves. In fact, some of them say, I've told my husband to remarry because I think there's some problem with me. Don't blame yourself. You haven't done anything to be in this condition. It's just unfortunate that maybe you have fibroids, you had endometriosis, you have some hormonal imbalance that has made you infertile. But be a friend to yourself is an extremely important advice. Time and again, I tell them. I often tell couples when they come for infertility, it is not necessary that you should have a child. There's no rule in India as yet that everyone should have a child. I said there are thousands of couples who are without a child, and some of them are voluntarily not wanting to have a child, and they're absolutely happy with themselves and in their relation. And I say that for every one couple whom you show is unhappy because they don't have the child, I will show you four couples who are unhappy only because they have children. So really, it doesn't mean that when you have a child, your life is suddenly going to change and you are going to have a very blissful and happy life. I said, we all go through the trials and tribulations of life. But yes, it is nice to parent. It is nice to be parent to somebody, to groom somebody, to put your values, to put your teachings into somebody. And it is a nice feeling. But unfortunately, sometimes you may be just not destined to have a child. So I think you should just leave it back and don't spend the rest of your life running in circles. In fact, I'm one of those who tell the patients, I'm not going to treat you. Now stop your treatment, because I think you are addicted to this. Because they come back. They come back. Somebody has to put them one step back and say, what are you doing? Why are you wasting all your finances, your holidays, and your reserves into this thing? Fine, you tried it. It's not happening. Kick it off. Start concentrating on something more better in life. And I'm sure you will not want to have a child at all. As I said, shifting focus is is also very important. And I try and tell them that don't make this the only goal in your life, that you're living only because you want to have a child. Refrain from blame. When in doubt of anything, check it up. You have got excellent information on the net. I think it's worth it going and checking. Remember why you want to have a baby in the first place. Maybe your priorities, your goals have shifted since the last 5 years you're trying to have a baby. So try and go back and see whether you really want to have that baby. Have fun together. Make love, not just babies. There are various ways you can de-stress yourself, and I think it is very, very important that our couples are counseled. In our country, unfortunately, as I said before, that infertility is a stigma. You are socially ostracized. In big cities also it happens, but in smaller cities and villages, I get patients who come and tell me that, you know, I'm fed up of this treatment. If you ask me personally, I don't want to have a child. But I can't go back and stay in that society because I'm ostracized. I'm not called for any religious function. I'm excluded from any fun, loving event that is happening in the society only because I don't have a child. And that's the only reason I want to have a child. I know women who go through phases and says, Doc, can I just go and steal a child and come back? Do you think that will help me? So they are willing to do anything to have that child, not because they want it, because the society wants them to have a child. And that is so much prevalent in India, and I'm sure it must be in some other countries, that they have social isolation, they are alienated, they are made to feel guilty, loss of social status. I had a woman who came from Singapore. She told me that she is the Prime Minister's personal secretary, and she said, I roam in such elite crowds, but the three questions that anybody would ask us in these social do's is, one is, what is your job? What is the PIN code so they know where you stay? And the third thing is, how many children you have? And she says, I've just come to tick mark that third thing from you. I don't want to have a child, but I need to answer that question to people, and that's the reason I've come. So it is so bizarre, and I was like, I said, this is really shocking. Who's going to look after your child? She says, I've got all the wealth and money. I said, but that doesn't mean that your child is going to be looked after. And I refused to treat her. She said, I need to see your ethical committee, because we have an ethical committee. And she wanted to do surrogacy. She didn't want to get pregnant herself because her job did not give her that leave that she would need to take for her delivery. So I said, I'm sorry, but you know, I don't think you're in the right frame of mind, and I think you're doing something totally wrong to yourself, and my ethical committee will not allow me to treat you. She said, I would want to stand in front of your ethical committee and tell them what social pressures women are going through in various countries. So this is happening in a as developed country as Singapore. So you can imagine what happens in our countries, what happens in our small villages, in our mofussil rural areas. It is terrible. It is terrible. It's like a curse, that if you don't have a child, you are cursed. And that is the problem. That is where domestic violence, sexual abuse, all that comes in, because she's absolutely helpless. She cannot stand up for herself because she's made to feel guilty day and night. You don't have a child, don't open your mouth. Don't give your opinion. You are useless. You're worthless. Whatever she may be doing, she may be earning double the salary of her husband, but when she's at home in that social circle, she is the one who's blamed, when we all know that 50% of the times infertility is because of male factor. But unfortunately to the society, it is the woman who is the one who bears the child, and that is the reason why it should be important that every woman, I think, must understand this, must get herself empowered. I tell women, don't take things lying down. If there is violence, if there's abuse in your relation, please let us know. We are there to help you. We are not only there to give you a child, but I think you are unnecessarily taking all the blame for whatever is going wrong in your relationship. We have a lot of NGOs, we have a lot of non-profit organizations who actually help us. There are lots of peer groups and support groups which are formed. Guidelines for treating couples with infertility. First and foremost, it should not be treated as a disease. It's just unfortunate that some of them can't have children when otherwise they're absolutely healthy by themselves. Recognize the sensitivity of management. As doctors, we have to empathize with them. We have to understand it's a very sensitive topic. We are actually intruding into people's sexual relationships. We must understand the importance of giving a quick diagnosis. As I said, they are the ones who wanted the child not tomorrow, but yesterday. And give them realistic assessment of their prognosis. Even infertility doesn't guarantee that you can actually give a child to every couple. It's not 100% successful treatment. When do I stop treating somebody? I think it's important that we consider all statistical guidelines. Provide a break, as I said. Sometimes I tell couples, just go off for 6 months. Because I have women who tell me, I'm fine till the day of my appointment. The minute I come onto your lane for your clinic, my heart starts beating rapidly. I start getting palpitations. I'm now wondering what next you're going to tell me. What is the next bad news that you're going to break to me? So if you are in that condition, I tell them, I think you need to take a break. I think you need to go on a holiday. You need to just close all your files and not think of it for the next 6 months. And I think then you must come back. Never tell a couple they cannot have a child. We have had so many instances when I've told couples, I don't think it's going to happen now. And then they go off, they forget about it, the stress level comes down because they are in that lowest pit. They can't go any low. And there, once the stress goes off, they get pregnant and they come back and they tell us, I've missed my period, I've done a urine pregnancy test without your knowledge, but doc, it's come positive. So it can happen. Any couple can get pregnant anytime. So never tell a couple never. And as I said, it's always important as doctors for us to broach on the topic of adoption. It is especially in our country when there are large number of children who are given up for adoption. I think that is one way that they can quickly realize their dreams of being parents. And frankly, I've yet, after proper counseling though, once we know that the couple, both of them are 100% for adoption, I've yet to have in my last 25 years of practice even one couple who has regretted their choice of adoption. They're all very happy. And they all come back and tell us, wish we had done this 5 years back. We'd have been able to enjoy the child much more. So, you know, it's that intensity of happiness which is there with them. Thank you very much. And I'm quite happy to answer some questions, if any.
Any questions? Thank you. I thought you'd understood everything or nothing.
Yes, it's more of the nothing.
Actually, the explanation was too good, so.
Thank you.
I personally wanted to know about surrogacy because I deal with certain kind of patient, and especially some of my friend who are, you know, I'm a counselor, so send me some, you know, like these kind of cases. But in India especially, surrogacy is not completely acceptable. The stress level is completely high at that time.
True.
What we need
I'll just
to do.
Take you. I will take you through how surrogacy has evolved the world over. Surrogacy was started off for medical reasons, which meant that if the woman had some medical disorder which would aggravate or make her life threatening if she got pregnant, then we would advise these women to opt for surrogacy, which is basically having that embryo from her and her husband grow into somebody else. So she's like an incubator, which will help that baby to grow. And after birth, that baby is given back to you because it's biologically yours. The second reason is there are some women who are born absent with uterus. They don't have a uterus since birth. Or their uterus is deformed because of multiple surgeries, multiple fibroid operations. Or if the uterus has become extremely weak, or the uterus has been removed for some early cancer or some early disease. In such women, again, surrogacy is an option. So these are medical reasons for surrogacy. Now there are social reasons for surrogacy. As I told you, my job doesn't entail me to take maternity leave, so I need to go for surrogacy. Now we have to, now just because a technology is available, that doesn't mean that you should access it. And that doesn't mean that the doctor should offer it. So there are some ethical guidelines where we as doctors should be drawing the line and saying up to here, beyond this, no. Often media tells you about women getting pregnant at 60 and 64 and say it's a medical marvel. It's nonsense. Completely nonsense. Because it is putting her at extreme risk and it is creating orphans in the world. Because obviously she's not going to live till 100 to look after this child. And we are going to make orphans of these babies. So there has to be some line where ethics has to come into play. And as I often say, just because I have the tool, I'm not going to go on using it. I have to be very selective in whom I offer. The third thing is that when a couple opts for surrogacy, because surrogacy is the one which is in media constantly. So now I have women who have self-diagnosed themselves. So they sit down in front of me and said, "Doctor, I need surrogacy." And I said, "Really? Wonderful. How did you know that?" Because that's the only thing that they've heard from media. So they know, they don't know that there are other modes of treatment. They just know surrogacy. In surrogacy, the couple has to be thoroughly counseled. Because a surrogate is going to look after a baby for 9 months. It's impossible to control somebody's life for 9 days. Forget 9 months. So it is not possible that you will be able to control, or she is going to do exactly what you would do in your pregnancy if you carried the baby. It is not possible. The flip side to that is the surrogate is already a mother of one or two children. So she thinks she's an expert. So she thinks that she knows about everything. So who's this woman who's never even had a baby trying to tell me stuff to do? So there's always going to be that conflict, and that's why you need to have a legal agreement in place, and the surrogate is looked after in a surrogate home to make sure that she's eating well and so on and so forth, and that she's medically looked after. But unfortunately, the social reasons for surrogacy has overtaken medical reasons. And that is why the government has now got up and has decided that this is too much, because women are being have been used as a commodity tool. They have been sometimes paid very low money for the risk that they take. And for that reason, now there are going to be some stringent laws. But as it happens in our government, the pendulum shifts from one end to the other. So the laws are so strict that even the deserving couple will not be able to do surrogacy in this country in a few months from now. So, but there has to be some balance. I think there are some deserving couples who need surrogacy. But unfortunately, because it was being misused more than used, we are now going to have stringent laws.
Guys, any other questions?
So, dear Dr. Sethi, thank you very much for your brilliant presentation. I've got a question. When couples come to you and they come because they've got this challenge, do you cooperate with homeopaths who could give them something to reduce the mental and emotional stress?
Yeah, there are various ways of reducing stress. Now, that's what I tell the couple. Like, sometimes even if I tell them about exercising, I tell them there are various things that you can do. Some people, if they want to exercise, they would like to go and jog alone. Some people would like to do a group activity like aerobics or yoga, whatever. So to reduce stress, it could be homeopathy, it could be meditation, it could be yoga, it could be finding some new hobby, could be anything. So yes, we do tell them that they need to reduce their stress. We can actually offer them what can be done, but it's not necessary that I would only say go and do homeopathy or Ayurveda, whatever they feel is right, because that itself is half the battle won. Once they choose a medium to reduce their stress, is half the battle won.
So thank you very much. Mr. Walter from Germany has got a question. I translate for him. He wants to know, kids being born out of IV.
Kids born out of IVF.
Yes, he said, he says that the divine, is there something missing when the divine out of the creation between man and woman is not there? And God, he asked, is something missing with them? That's his question.
I don't think so, because even IVF is through God's medium. Just because it's science which is assisting them, it is not that we are trying to do something which nature has not done. It is assisting nature. So IVF is part of nature. It is trying to assist nature to help these couples have children. I think scientifically, if you go to see, these children do not have any defects. However, children where there is severe male factor infertility can have some genetic disorders, but they are very far and rare. But by far and large, scientifically, these children growth parameters and IQ levels and everything is same. In fact, I tell my couples that just because you have done IVF, that doesn't mean that your child cannot have abnormalities. Because that's what they feel, that I've done IVF means my child cannot have any defects. It's not true. Your child will have the same background defects that normally conceived children will have. So it's a reverse also holds true. Yeah.
If it is thalassemia, minor, both husband, wife.
Yes.
And then if
there's
you have
a 25% chance that this child can have thalassemia major, which is a life crippling disorder.
Yeah.
So IVF helps such couples by a procedure called as PGD, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, which means that the couple, even if they are able to have children on their own, they undergo IVF. And the embryos on the second day of fertilization, we biopsy the embryo from an 8-cell embryo. We take out one cell, and that one cell is subjected to testing to check and see if there is thalassemia major. If there is thalassemia minor or normal, those embryos are safe to be transferred back into the woman. The cells which exhibit thalassemia major are destroyed.
And can you throw some light onto recent developments regarding this plasma bank or what? I don't know.
Cord blood banking. Cord blood banking. Cord blood banking is after the birth of the baby, there is some blood which is going to remain in the umbilical cord and in the placenta, which is not from the mother. It is from the fetal circulation. So that blood actually goes waste. So that blood is collected in special media, and we can actually concentrate the cells from those cord blood that is available, and it can be stored for many, many years. Now, what is the reason for storing this is because these are stem cells, which means these cells can be stimulated to grow into any tissue of the body. And these cells, because they come from this child, they are compatible with that child. They are 50% times compatible with the sibling and in the parents. So suppose if I was born in this day and age, I would have the umbilical cord blood stored in a cord blood bank. And God forbid, after 15, 20 years, if I'm diagnosed to have leukemia, or if I'm diagnosed to have some bone cancer or some pancreatic disease or early onset diabetes, any of these conditions, then these cells can be taken and the lab can stimulate them to grow into pancreatic cells, and then they are injected into me. So that is what the cord blood bank does, that they can store a part of your cells, which are the stem cells, which are immature cells, and they can be stimulated to grow into any tissue of your body. And they are compatible because they are part of you.
All you being a doctor and everybody is aware that stress creates most of the health problems, and we all are mental health practitioners, counselors and therapists. And how about you seeing such alternative therapists and hospital and helping people out much before they get into the worst of the illness?
Absolutely. So in medicine, there are two types of therapies. One is a curative therapy, so you wait for the disease to happen and then you cure it, or there is something like a preventive medicine, which is a big arm of medicine. Nowadays, the whole world is running around preventive medicine. So you go and undergo screening tests to find out if you are susceptible to a particular disease. So same way, so people are offered alternative help to reduce their stress. And I think there are lots of corporates who are also doing it at their end. There are lots of corporates who have got recreational centers in their workplace. They have got various different aids, and actually it starts right from school itself, where you have counselors, where you can go and talk to them. Because most often these problems start very early on in age. And I feel it is a relationship problem. I am also involved with children with learning disabilities and dyslexias and autism. And every single time when you go deep, you find that there's a relationship problem between the parents. And that's the first thing that stands up in these children. And this is the child trying to ask for help. So his dysfunctional behavior, him not doing scholastically well, his dyslexia, autism, is all related to parental relationships. Yeah. Yeah, by increasing awareness of people like you. Till I did not meet Anu, I did not know what meta health was, frankly. So only when I met her and we got talking and she told me what she does, and that got me interested, and I said, I need to know more about you. She said, no, first you talk and you tell me more, because I need to know more about what you are doing. So that's how we got to talk with each other, and that's how I came to know about meta health. I mean, frankly, till then I didn't know what meta health was.
So I just wanted to share, I had somebody who could not conceive for nearly 1 year after the marriage. And she was under some stress. And it so happened that she was knowing a friend of mine, and that's how through the friend-friend contact she had come. So as soon as I did just 3 therapy to reduce her stress, okay, the third one she gave me the good news regarding. So just to let you know that we all exist with so many different modalities, and if you all can just help us come across the patients.
Anu, I said next time when we have our doctors' conferences, we are going to have some sessions where we have these therapies. So people should be aware, because only when I know that there is people like this in my city and I can refer patients, only then that awareness is not there, frankly.
Yeah, sure.
People are not aware.
Because we have
to, I think you all need to go and get more
awareness to a lot of other people. Yes. That's what I think. Yeah, because so many different issues have come up, right from the very young age children.
True.
To the working parents, and working parents bringing up their babies to
even in old age. Yeah, because
old
once
age
they
becoming
are
becoming so isolated after
retired,
retirement.
They finished their work, their children have left home, or one of their partners has expired. Even at that stage, they need some counseling, they need help, they need somebody to talk to.
Because people don't address this problem,
you know,
mental and emotional problems.
There was a very famous ad of British Telecom 20 years back, let's talk.
Yeah.
And which is true now, because now people don't talk to each other. It's all WhatsApp, it's email, nobody picks up the phone and talks to anybody.
That's what I'm saying.
It is so impersonal. You get a mail from somebody, I've been in correspondence with somebody for the last 1.5 years staying in Mumbai, and I've never even bothered to meet that person. I don't know who that person is. If it comes in front of me, I don't know. And I'm sure we all must be going through this. So let's talk is something which British Telecom 20 years back they used to advertise.
Thank you
so much.
But
for a different reason, of course.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We have 2 more questions and we don't have time. Yeah. But if we can make it really quick, because both the questions seem really, really important.
She's been patiently waiting.
Yes. So the question that Lena had was, if you freeze the eggs at the age of 20, is it okay then to get pregnant with those eggs at the age of 34, 35 or 40?
Yes, it's called as social freezing. Again, this procedure of egg freezing was evolved for medical reasons. When young girls were diagnosed to have leukemias, lymphomas, breast cancers, which necessitated them to have chemo or radiotherapy, which would destroy their ovarian activity. So we would actually sometimes stimulate the eggs and remove the eggs, or sometimes we have removed pieces of the ovary and freeze that and kept, which can be later transplanted back into the woman once she's healthy. So that's the medical reason for doing egg freezing in these women. Now, of course, social egg freezing is more rampant. Women want to get on with their careers. Women do not want to have children till particular age. But these women need to be really counseled properly, because they freeze their eggs. And sometimes, as I often tell women, there's never a right time to get married and there's never a right time to get children. It has to happen in the course of time that you're doing. So these are the very women who will freeze their eggs, but half of them will never use it because they never find the right time to do it.
The last two questions was? Sorry.
I wanted to ask a similar question about the ovarian eggs being frozen. But is there a timeline?
No, there is no timeline. They are suspended in time. So you can use them after 5 years. You can use them after 15 years.
And there's no degeneration.
There is no deterioration. Unfortunately for us, we have to take consents. We have lots of men who have freezed their sperms. We have lots of women who have freezed their eggs. And they have lost contact with us. So now here we are with those frozen samples and not knowing where they have gone off in the world. So we take consents for 5 years and we necessitate them to come back and re-consent, because lots of them change their addresses, phone numbers and everything, and we are at a loss what to do with these thousands of sperm samples and
so eggs. So it doesn't ever degenerate?
Not
so
at
you
all.
Can, so yes. There is no timeline?
Or there is virtually no timeline.
Okay.
Virtually no timeline. You can use them after 5 years or even 15 years.
There seem to be a lot more questions. Should we continue?
No, Dr. I think Tracy? The next speaker is waiting, so maybe on another time.
So I think what we can do is you write your question down. Maybe you're going to be here for some time?
Yes.
Wonderful. And we could give those questions to you, and maybe people who have these questions can personally come up to you and get the answers. Would that be good?
That's absolutely fine.
Thank you so much. I am really, really, really blessed today.
And thank you all of you. It was wonderful meeting y'all, and I hope to see you more often. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Patki, for all the information, and I'm sure you will be meeting lots of people here. They want to ask questions to you. Now it's time for some puppet show. So we okay.
सवारी चा घेतला पावलानी आवाड वंजी तुझी सावली गळा पेट घेण्या भी नेची निघाली तुझ्या नाम घोषा
Out in the garden, the flowers bowed their colorful heads to the wind that blows. Sometimes they lift their heads up to greet the little bees that visit them. One of the flowers, a pretty sunflower, unique and beautiful, in her own ways happy with all the attention from her friend, the bumblebee. The flowers asked her why she seems so happy and blushing. She replies, "A bee with me seems very much in love." There is a growing familiarity between the bee and the flower, who begin to trust the bee. The bee turns showers his attention on the lovely flower, but something seems wrong. Is this love or something else?
Tonight, the dancing bumblebee takes flight, and all the flowers in the field prepare the nectar soon to yield. Dance, dance, fly.
make you warm and right. I'll make you warm tonight. Come in. He danced until the morning came. Until the music's last refrain. And though he knew it soon would end, he'd only live to dance again.
How the lovely flower was totally destroyed. With all the trust, with all the love that she had for the bumblebee, and that was the end of her. Thank you. This is something that we show in this school section for the age group between.
What we have seen is after this particular show, many of the girls and boys too,
they have come around and talked about sexual abuse to their counselors. And most abuse obviously is starting at home and in their own homes when their parents are at work actually. And the counselors are very happy about this particular show because, you know, that's how they're able to kind of open up, the children are able to open up very easily. Thank you so much.
Yeah, so I'm just going to take 1 minute. So I was introduced to Meta Health about 1.5 years back, and back then I didn't know that there was something inside me. What happened when I was 3 years old? So I was abused by the maid who used to take care of me, and it was actually Lena who recognized it the first time when we were doing Time of Alchemy with Rob. And after that, of course, I realized and I healed myself. And Anu has. Really, yeah, she's helped me come over all the feelings of isolation and unprotected, whatever I felt. And today I stand here doing the puppetry show fearlessly. It's all because of Meta Health and Anu. Thank you.
So how was the puppet show? Good. Right. So we are working towards making our conference more interactive, interesting, and of course learning is unquestionable.